Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here, your favorite brother from another mother, back home. We went ahead and came home tonight. We had ended up having to rent a hotel room to do the baptisms. Praise God. We had seven baptisms, and seven, I do believe. We had nine people there. By the grace of God, only one person was not able to make it. The brother, he was busy. He was busy driving a race car. As a matter of fact, he wasn't able to make it. That's, you know, how it goes. But anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, I've done a lot of, I've done dozens of people baptized here in the States. And even though a whole lot more in the Philippines, but in America with the visitations I've done, I've been able to baptize dozens of people and meet with dozens and dozens of people. But I usually don't have, take pictures. But praise God, there was a sister who was able to take pictures. And I'm trying to make sure I pronounce her name right. Shalia, Sister Shalia. She had already been baptized, and she wanted to be prayed for. So she was kind enough, and I thank the Lord that she was there. She took pictures of all the people being baptized. And before I show more of these pictures, I just wanted to do this because I want to encourage you guys. People want to meet me to be baptized, and people that, you know, that are new, that don't know me. People, of course, have been watching me for years. You know, they know me from my videos. You get to know people. We keep making videos and videos and people being, you know, being themselves. You can tell whether people are, you know, legitimate or some kind of fake or whatever, you know, over time of watching people. But anyway, water baptism is something that all Christians should do, and we need someone to baptize us. There are people that have baptized themselves, and they say that they feel peace in their heart about it, and they went ahead and did it. I mean, that's between ultimately these things when it comes to God. Is a conviction in our heart. So when people ask me, so as a matter of fact, people ask me that all the time, can I baptize myself? And I always say, well, in my opinion, biblically speaking, you can't really do that. But if you feel that you can do it and you feel like you got Bible verses to support that and you can live with that, I mean, that's between you and God. I mean, ultimately, our relationship with God is between us and God. It's really, you know, no one else to make that decision for us. That's why, you know, I love to quote the Bible verse about salvation. It says, let his spirit bear witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Or his spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're children of God. And that's Romans 8:16. Now let me say this sister's name again. Sorry, Sister Shalia. I you know, it takes me time sometimes to get names in my head. But Sister Shalia, who I met today, who took the pictures for us, she's asking for a prayer, brothers and sisters. And I would ask for a special prayer for her. She is a student. And she's finished 1 year of college, and she had this scholarship. But now, since she got saved, like just the last couple of years, I rededicated her life, got right with God, and then, you know, and then God's been moving her around and making changes in her life. And she needs to go, and she feels led by the Lord. She's going to go back to school in August. She's got some financial debt she needs to pay and things like that. So I asked you guys to pray for her about that and God. And, you know, I got a word from the Lord for her when I prayed with her that God would give her direction. Now that she's dedicated her life to the Lord, God would, you know, guide and direct her in her life. You know, and so I'm asking you guys to pray for her. And I know there's lots of you who are prayer warriors. And, you know, the Bible says one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. So I ask you guys to pray for her because she needs that clear direction from the Lord. She needs favor to pay off her. She has some a debt that she has to get her transcript released to transfer schools. And for her, she's getting a scholarship for athletics. But she needs to get her transcript and all that. So I ask you guys to pray. She needs housing. And I ask you guys to pray about that because their housing is full there. So she's a nice sister. She's a younger person, you know. Maybe she, I think she's, I didn't ask her, 20, 21 years old, something like that. And so, you know, she wants to serve the Lord. And it's not many people, you know, like I've said many times, I meet tons of people. Very few people say, hey, Brother Patrick, can you pray for me? I want to serve the Lord. She's one of the few, brothers and sisters. And that's why I'm taking the time and the effort to ask you guys to pray for her. Because she's young. She can do something for God a lot. I mean, even though we always say, oh, no matter how old you are, God can use you. That's true. But, you know, she's a young person. And God can really use her. And he will use, he's so fast to use young people. Because there's so few young people that want to give their life to the Lord. So I ask you guys to pray for her. And revelation. If you get any word from the Lord for her, any of you guys who are good prayer warriors, please message me and then I'll get it to her. Maybe, you know, you can even connect with her. I'll do that. Help you guys get connected. Some more mature sisters in the Lord. All right. This is some of the people that we baptized. There's a brother who came down, and I was able to baptize him. And by the grace of God, I think his wife needs to be baptized too, I think. And then next time we could do that, she was unable to come this time. And a family came up, and that's them, you know, and I told them we're going to be showing these pictures. So we baptized even some children. And I'm just going through these. And I think I've already shown all these. I'm just going through them again. That's all of them. Maybe I had some of them twice. Anyway, by the grace of God, we were able to baptize 7 people. And praise God for that, brothers and sisters. And of course, it's so important also that I pray with people who need to be prayed for. And that's, to me, of course, baptism, this is what we were doing. This occasion, God lined it up for baptisms as the priority. But, you know, baptisms is something that we need to do. You need to be obedient to the Lord to be baptized if you're saved, as soon as you can. And I get people ask me every day, will I be raptured if I'm not baptized, water baptized? I say, yes, you are. But if you've been saved for 10 years, you know, and you didn't make any effort to get baptized, and you're just, you know, clowning around, the question is, you know, why are you not being obedient to God? You know, it's, you know, you need to question, you know, why are you not being obedient? Because baptism doesn't save us, but it's the first act. It's supposed to be the first act of obedience to the Word of God. Even in the book of Acts, when we see the eunuch who was evangelized by Philip the evangelist, going back to Ethiopia, and they came along the river, and then, you know, after he had given the gospel to the eunuch, the eunuch's like, what's stopping me from being baptized right now? There's water right there. And he's like, yeah, okay. And he went down there and baptized him. And then, of course, Philip was called away and not seen. He was actually translated from that place. But people get caught up on that point. But the focus that I'm getting at, focus right here, what I'm getting at is the fact that the eunuch, part of the gospel, was that you need to be water baptized. Because the eunuch said, hey, what's stopping me from getting baptized right now? You know, you want to be baptized. And so, and baptism is important, and it needs to be done by somebody. And it's really someone who is an elder in the church, deacon, you know. And there are people on YouTube who are not from, you know, a denominational church, but they are called by God to be elders in the church. You know, and all preachers, I've mentioned this before, a lot of people say they never heard that. Preachers are elders, because it talks about people being worth a double portion or a double honor. It's talking about giving money to the elders for their service to the body of Christ. But it says particularly double honor to those who teach. So elders, not all elders are preachers, but all preachers are elders, supposed to be. So when you talk about a church, you have your elders. You have people who are mature in the faith, who are either the preacher or deacons, or some churches have elders and not deacons. And then they have, you know, people who are in leadership in the church, and Sunday school teachers and things like that. Usually they would be categorized in that section of what we call elders. Now, they can be recognized by a man-made denomination or not. God knows who, and people know their calling. Just like you know you're saved, there are people who know they're called to be a deacon. They're called to be an elder in the church. They're called to be a pastor. So, you know, they can baptize people. They can baptize people. So then there are people who feel comfortable baptizing themselves. That's between them and God. I personally don't agree with that. I don't think you should do that. Someone should baptize you. As a brother that I met there that I baptized in one of those pictures, he said, well, you know, this brother right here, he was telling me, well, you know, even Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. He didn't baptize himself, you know. And Jesus said to John the Baptist, you know, this must be done to fulfill all righteousness. So John the Baptist baptized Jesus. So he didn't, you know, if the Lord needs to be baptized by somebody who's called by God, then I think we all should be. And there are people who baptize each other, but they're not elders in the church. You know, like I say, if you're in a pinch and you don't have any other choice, you can do that. But the problem is with the YouTube people, you know, just like when you've got the extreme over-organization of the Catholic Church and some of these denominations, on the other extreme, we have anarchy and everybody doing their own will of lots of the people on YouTube. You know, they can't be corralled even at all. You know, someone had their YouTube name. I think they've changed it. A sister had one called Herding Cats. Is their YouTube handle. So, you know, that's pretty good. I mean, dealing with people on YouTube in the church is like herding cats. I mean, you know, it's just, you know, everybody's kind of doing their own thing. And, of course, we have our individual relationship with the Lord. Yes, we have autonomy. And, yes, you know, that we're not under the control of some, you know, these denominations who are leading people away from God, actually, and leading people into the hands of the Antichrist. We know that. But, as I said, you know, the other extreme is this anarchy that I deal with every day on YouTube. People are totally, you know, they won't even obey anybody. They won't come under the authority of anybody. And God did clearly put authority in the church. As I always quote Ephesians 4:11, starting at verse 11, it says, He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers for the perfecting of the saints, you know, until we all come together into the one man. And so that's basically that I mentioned. I mean, that's the main thing that I deal with, you know, that people deal with trolls. Now, we have atheists and all that stuff who like to mock God. I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about Christians who love to troll and say things like, oh, you know, if you believe in the rapture is from the devil. Anybody that believes in the rapture is going to hell. Anybody that believes in the rapture is not saved. You know, they want to challenge the authority of God's elders, but not in the proper way where you do it through privately and all that kind of stuff, but some kind of a, you know, comment, starting debate and strife and all this. And like I say, this is what we deal with people who are, you know, taking their liberty as an individual in Christ to an extreme and not being part of the body. Because the Bible also says in Hebrews, you know, I believe it's Hebrews chapter 10, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together when you see that day approaching. What day? The day of the return of the Lord. When the rapture is getting close, don't forsake assembling with other Christians. So, you know, but churches use that same verse to say, like, oh, if you don't go to church, you're not right with God, you know. And as an example, the Catholic Church comes out and says, you know, that you have to die in a state of grace to go to heaven. And so how do you get in a state of grace? By participating in the sacraments of the church. That's what the Catholic Church calls sacraments. So what is that? What are they? You know, taking the communion or what they call the Eucharist, by having the last rites read to you when you die, by getting married in the Catholic Church. Although, you know, they have how many ever sacraments of the church. I used to know all the details all about. Yeah, becoming a priest is one of the sacraments. And all those things. But, you know, and then they're sprinkling babies' heads when they're born. They call it baptism and all that. But we call it christening, you know, dedicating the child to Christ. They call it, that's your baptism. But anyway, so they give all this authority that, hey, you got to do everything through us or you're not in a state of grace. That's one extreme. That's not biblical. And then on the other, you know, giving all power to the church. And then on this other extreme where people are like, hey, they're an island unto themselves, do whatever they want. Because Jesus set it all up. God set up the church to where we have to rely on each other. That's why Paul said, you know, the foot can't say to the hand, I don't need you. And the ear can't say to the eye, I don't need you, and all that. You know, you can't hear with your eyes and you can't see with your ear. But some people can see and some people can hear. You know, that's why we need to come together in unity, because we all see through a glass darkly. You know, no man has all the answers. And that's why when people are trolling, and they're challenging people, you know, about all these questions about the rapture or whatever topic, you know, nobody knows everything. And when people think they know everything, that's when you end up with a cult. You know, a cult leader is infallible. Like I mentioned the Catholic Church again, the Pope in the doctrine of the Catholic Church, when he's sitting on the throne of Peter, they call it, and he speaks a word as the Pope, he's infallible. He cannot make an error. He's inerrant like the Bible, which is not true. Every cult that you find, you know, the cult leader is infallible. Nobody challenges the cult leader. It's always the same thing, brothers and sisters. So there's that balance that we need. And part of that is to be water baptized. That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to help. The Lord has sent me in the U.S. to try to gather up some of these stragglers who are riding the fence between anarchy and coming on into the body of Christ and submitting themselves under to the outskirts of the authority of the kingdom of God. I'm kind of at the city limits of the authority of the church, try to bring you on in, you know, and lead you on into being a part of the city, the community of the body of Christ. One of those steps is water baptism by someone who is in authority in the church, universal, brothers and sisters. So anyway, God bless you guys. Praise God. I just wanted to share these pictures because I never have any, because my focus is the ministry, not to make, you know, pictures out of it, you know. But I thought I would show this. It might encourage people who are new and say, yeah, they're, you know, Pastor Patrick's really baptizing people and stuff. So you'd be encouraged and maybe that you would get baptized. So God bless you guys. I ask you for your prayers for the sister that I mentioned at the beginning. I ask for your prayers for all the people that were baptized. And then I ask for your prayers as we get ready to go to Chicago, July 22nd through the 24th, and then, or 25th, and then 25th through the 27th in Minneapolis. Ask for your prayers for that, and RSVPs for people that I will meet. I already have a big crowd in both places for baptism, but I will baptize anybody that shows up. Just let me know so I can talk to you for a few minutes and make sure you're really saved. Discuss that with you about baptism and stuff individually before we do it. Anyway, God bless you, brothers and sisters. God bless.